So now it's my honor to introduce Mr. Peter Ho. When I first met Peter Ho in 2009, he was the head of the Singapore Civil Service. I only later realized that that was only one of many functions and responsibilities that he held at that time. And the number seems only to have increased after he retired from the Singapore Administrative Service in August 2010. In August this year, President Tan awarded him the prestigious Distinguished Service Award, recognizing his many and great contributions in Singapore. That award may suggest that Peter is at the end of his career, but looking at what he is doing at the moment, I would rather say it was a celebration of his mid-career peak. The contributions that I am most familiar with are his initiative to set up the Center for Strategic Futures, his work on foresight, his leading role in risk assessment and horizon scanning, and his strong support for the complexity program at NTU. All these are of direct relevance to Singapore's capabilities to deal with the uncertainty of the future. And thus it is with great pleasure, appreciation, and anticipation that I ask Peter Ho to give his talk, Societies at Risk, Taming Black Elephants and Hunting Black Swans.
Good morning to all of you, Mr. Inderjit Singh and friends and colleagues. Disruptions are disturbances to the normal flow of life. It could be a cyber attack, a new virus, a violent storm, civil unrest, economic turbulence, and so on. And they happen because we live in an interconnected world. And what happens in one part of the world can obviously affect other parts of the world. This is the so-called butterfly effect, which postulates that the flap of a butterfly's wings in Brazil can set off a tornado in Texas. This was the title of a lecture by Dr. Edward Lorenz a few decades ago. And at the core of the butterfly effect is the concept that small disturbances can have large effects. Globalization increases and intensifies connections, as does the internet. Urbanization is accelerating and densely connecting people as never before. And because of these connections, events and actions interact with each other in complex ways to produce effects that are emergent and often surprising and disruptive. And as connections intensify, the frequency of disruptions will increase and the amplitude of their impact will grow. Singapore's founding Prime Minister, the late Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, said, "The past was not preordained, nor is the future, and there are as many unexpected problems ahead as there were in the past." Now, all this sounds like a truism, but it is the reality. And some of these unexpected problems or disruptions will be of the black swan variety. That means rare, hard to predict events with a large impact. If disruption is a constant in our world of volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity, this is a US military term, or VUCA, then it behoves us to spend time thinking about how individuals, organizations, societies, and countries can respond. In our VUCA world, the preemption and prevention of disruption, despite our best efforts, cannot be guaranteed. The name of the game, therefore, shifts from imperviousness to disruption to recovering and even growing after being disrupted. Judith Rodin, the president of the Rockefeller Foundation, and who launched the 100 Resilient Cities Initiative, of which Singapore is a part, provides a good definition of resilience. And she writes, "Resilience is the capacity of any entity, an individual, a community, an organization, or natural system to prepare for disruptions, to recover from shocks and stresses, and then to adapt and grow from a disruptive experience. Now, many disruptions, natural disasters, pandemics, even financial crises and political upheavals, which we've been talking about, do not fall into the category of black swans or Donald Rumsfeld's unknown unknowns. Instead, more often than not, they are either known knowns or known unknowns. Now, once upon a time, all disasters, storms, floods, earthquakes, and volcanic eruptions arrived without warning. Today, modern science helps to predict such cataclysms with increasingly accuracy. And many disruptions can now be assigned probabilities. And this ought to lead governments to take precautionary measures, but often they do not. And the reasons they do not are several, centered on a special type of failure that all human beings are prone to, and these are our cognitive biases or our blind spots, and it is deeply embedded in our human nature. In his book Collapse, the polymath Jared Diamond alludes to the inability to read trends or to see behind the phenomenon of creeping normality. Things just get a little bit worse each year than the year before, but not bad enough for anyone to notice. For example, our tardy response to climate change is a textbook case study of this phenomenon. Indeed, people have a hard time properly ascertaining the present value of events that will take place in the future. This tendency to discount the future, to place less emphasis on future risks and contingencies, and instead to place more weight on present costs and benefits, is a common cognitive bias known among behavioral economists as present bias preferences or hyperbolic discounting. The institutional position that political leaders occupy discourages them from spending time worrying about the problem that will, hopefully, occur only after they have left office. Democratic governments are often catatonic in the face of problems whose consequences are expected to be felt only in the distant future. At the risk of generalization, governments tend to focus on immediate problems and priorities related to the electoral cycle. They would rather defer expenditure on something that may or may not happen. Which leads me to a new member of my menagerie, the black elephant. And you may ask, what is the black elephant? The black elephant is a cross between a black swan and the elephant in the room. The black elephant is a problem that is actually visible to everyone, the proverbial elephant in the room, but nobody wants to deal with it, and so they pretend it is not there. And when it blows up as a problem, we all feign surprise and shock, behaving as if it was a black swan. In 2013, a small Ebola outbreak in Guinea ballooned into an international health emergency in 2014. Over 10,000 people died, and the economic cost to the affected nations in West Africa was estimated in the billions of dollars. But it could all have been nipped in the bud if appropriate and aggressive actions, including by the World Health Organization, had been taken at the start. Arguably, this is an example of a black elephant. Unfortunately, the tendency of the human mind is to underestimate both sudden crises as well as slow burn issues. The result is organizational hesitation. Until events reach crisis proportions, no one takes any action. On 25th February 2003, the SARS virus entered Singapore through three women who had returned from Hong Kong with symptoms of atypical pneumonia. They had stayed at the Hotel Metropole in Hong Kong, where a doctor from Guangzhou, China, was also staying. He was afflicted with what became known as the severe acute respiratory syndrome, or SARS, which is thought to have emerged in Guangdong province sometime in November 2002. Now, the virus then spread with frightening speed through the hospital system. It confounded our medical authorities in the beginning. They did not know how the virus spread and why it spread so aggressively. The fatality rate was shocking. By the time the SARS crisis was declared over in Singapore, 33 people had died out of the 238 who had been infected. SARS was a black swan for Singapore. Not only was it a big shock, but it was also a very frightening time for Singaporeans. Then Prime Minister Goh Chok Tong told the BBC in April 2003 that this was a crisis of fear. Overnight, visitor arrivals plunged and the entire tourism industry came to a grinding halt. SARS severely affected the Singapore economy, leading to a contraction during the second quarter of that year. Now, there will be more of such crises. And when the normal flow of life is disrupted, societies will need resilience to cope. Now, Singapore's response to SARS is well documented. One of the most critical early decisions was to designate SARS a national crisis and not just a public health problem. This meant that all the resources of government, and in fact of the whole nation, could be harnessed in a whole-of-government approach to tackle the wicked problem of SARS. The SAF put an entire division, army division, at the disposal of the health authorities. The police did likewise. Within weeks, MINDEF's Defence Science and Technology Agency, or DSTA, and DSO National Laboratories developed a contact tracing system, as well as an infrared fever screening system, now adopted around the world. In fact, the gentleman lurking in the background is here in the audience, Mr. Tan Yang Hao. And such innovations epitomize resilience during the crisis. But this could not have been achieved if the government had been organized with an obsessive focus on efficiency and optimization. These are well and good if everything goes according to plan. But things rarely go as planned. Many times, we cannot predict when disruptions will occur. Nicholas Nassim Taleb, he of the Black Swan, notes that disruptions occur in overly optimized systems, that when disruptions occur in overly optimized systems, errors compound, multiply, swell, with an effect that only goes in one direction, the wrong direction. So to deal with disruptions, governments must go beyond an emphasis on efficiency. Lean systems that focus exclusively on efficiency are unlikely to have sufficient resources to deal with unexpected shocks and volatility. As Taleb notes, redundancy is ambiguous because it seems like a waste if nothing happens, except that something usually happens, something unusual happens usually. So we have to ask ourselves a key question. If disruption is inevitable, then how can we develop a system that is resilient to shocks? The answer to this question determines which country, especially those like Singapore, with no natural resource, is going to stay on a sustainable trajectory over the long term. The ability to quickly and decisively respond to crises and disruptions helps to manage uncertainty arising from our VUCA world. Now, this is not an argument for establishing bloated and sluggish bureaucracies, but one important idea is to have a small but dedicated group of people to think about the future, who will identify contingencies to be planned for, and will seek out emerging risks over the horizon that need to be managed. The skill sets needed are different from those required to deal with short-term volatility and crisis. Those charged with thinking about the future should be allocated the bandwidth to focus on the long term without getting bogged down in day-to-day routine. Now, this will not eliminate shocks, but by improving the ability to anticipate such shocks, their frequency and impact might actually be reduced. In turn, this will help make governments and nations more resilient. Another part of the answer is the availability of reserves. If not reserves in natural resource, then other kinds of national reserves built from prudent planning. The SEF, Singapore Armed Forces, and its supporting organizations like DSTA and DSO are reserves of the nation in the sense that they are an insurance premium for a contingency that hopefully will never occur. But without that fat in the system, it is doubtful that Singapore would have been able to respond to the SARS crisis as it did in 2003. Singapore's government is also committed to build ample national reserves from the savings and surpluses of the national budget, giving the country a buffer to draw in times of crisis. And during the 2007-2008 global financial crisis, the government for the first time actually drew on the national reserves in the form of a $20.5 billion resilience package. And this was primarily aimed at preserving and enhancing business competitiveness, as well as promoting job retention during a period of great uncertainty. A key aspect involved encouraging firms not to retrench workers, but to support retraining programs, as well as temporary part-time arrangements. And once the world economy began to recover, Singaporean firms were able to respond with alacrity and speed to catch the winds of global economic recovery. Now, SkillsFuture, which was mentioned by our guest of honor, Mr. Inderjit Singh, is another example of how Singapore tries to future-proof the workforce by establishing a norm of lifelong learning. And I won't go into detail, but this is part of a larger effort to ensure that Singapore remains resilient in the face of uncertainty and shock. The whole of government approach adopted for SARS had a compelling logic. People from different organizations, both from within and outside government, came together to pool their knowledge in order to discover and develop solutions for dealing with the deadly SARS outbreak and to combine their resources to meet the demands of the crisis. But while whole-of-government approach may be a logical imperative, it is not easily achieved. Governments, like any large hierarchical organization, tend to optimize at the departmental level rather than at the whole-of-government level. Whole-of-government responses to contingencies must be practiced. Otherwise, the muscle of the government machinery becomes flabby and atrophies from lack of use. And that is why, every now and then in Singapore, there are exercises on the ground involving not just the authorities and the uniformed groups, but even members of the public, which is a whole-of-nation approach. Jared Diamond recounts the story of the Netherlands, where one-fifth of the total land area is below sea level, reclaimed from the sea over the centuries, and protected by a complex system of dikes and pumping operations. These reclaimed lands are called polders. The Dutch have a clear sense that we are all living in the same polder and that our survival depends on each other's survival. This is a country that has developed a resilient response to a constant existential threat, which is flooding, through a combination of whole-of-nation solidarity and smart engineering. During the SARS crisis in Singapore, the authorities did many things that had no precedent, including contact tracing, temperature screening, and home quarantine. As the saying goes, necessity is the mother of invention. For example, electronic monitoring bracelets were issued in order to enforce quarantine orders. a security company, Cisco, was deployed to keep track of people quarantined at home. And initially, these measures were predictably denounced in the Western press as draconian. But later on, many of these measures were quietly adopted by other cities afflicted by SARS. Being prepared to take such aggressive measures was a key part of an effective response to the SARS crisis. In his April 2003 BBC interview, then PM Goh explained, and I quote, "I'm being realistic because we do not quite know how this," meaning SARS, "will develop. This is a global problem, and we are at the early stage of the disease. If it becomes a pandemic, then it's going to be a big problem for us. I'd rather be proactive and be a little overreacting so that we get people who are to quarantine themselves to stay at home. The whole idea is to prevent the spread of infection," unquote. In other words, when dealing with serious disruptions where there's a lot of uncertainty, it is often better to overshoot rather than to undershoot. Now, another issue is at play, fear. It rears its head not only during deadly epidemics. Even in financial crises, such as in 2008 after Lehman Brothers collapsed, fear can go viral. As FDR, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, said during the Great Depression in 1933, "The only thing we have to fear is fear itself." The dissemination of trusted information is an important way of managing fear. During the SARS outbreak, Singapore took a transparent approach. For example, the government gave the World Health Organization, or WHO, unfettered access to information. Every afternoon during the crisis, all the data and information collated from the previous 24 hours was presented at a conference chaired by the Director of Medical Services, or DMS. WHO observers attended it. They had access to the same raw data as Ministry of Health officials. The government also laid bare the uncertainties and risks during SARS, even as other countries sought to reassure their citizens that SARS was under control. Singaporeans' leaders told people not only what they knew, but also what they did not know. They shared their concerns. They avoided providing false assurances. This diffusion of trusted information, transparency, laying bare uncertainties, and acting with empathy built on underlying trust, not just of the people in the government, but also of the government in the people. Singaporeans trusted the government for its efficiency and integrity. The government trusted Singaporeans to deal with uncertainty as the SARS outbreak unfolded. This two-way trust between the government and the people formed a deep source of national resilience in Singapore during SARS. Now, if SARS was a black swan for Singapore, then arguably the Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, or MERS, outbreak in 2015 was more of a black elephant for South Korea. Because by then, health authorities around the world had developed mechanisms to deal with atypical and novel respiratory diseases after experiences with things like SARS, swine flu, and bird flu. Furthermore, MERS had already emerged some years earlier, in fact in 2012 in Saudi Arabia, so the condition and its dangers were not unknown. In fact, because of its high morbidity rate, which stood at around 40%, even worse than SARS, authorities around the world were on high alert. On 20th May 2015, South Korea reported its first imported case of MERS. By the time Seoul declared the outbreak over, nearly 17,000 people had been quarantined, 186 people had been infected, and 36 people died. Thousands of schools were closed. The number of tourists fell 40% in June from a year earlier. Faced with a barrage of questions in early June 2015, the Korean Center for Disease Control and Prevention, KCDC, closed its Twitter account to the public, only to reopen it the following day. As the Korea Times put it in an editorial, adding to the mounting public concerns was a lack of information, the exact area affected, the list of hospitals, the first patient, and those infected by him, leading to the spread of groundless rumors and swelling unfounded fears in a vicious circle. So although the outbreak was eventually brought under control, the government was criticized for its slow response to the outbreak and for stoking fears by failing to effectively communicate public health risks. Judith Rodin says that as you build resilience, you become more able to prevent or mitigate stresses and shock you can identify, and better able to respond to those you can't predict or avoid. You also develop greater capacity to bounce back from a crisis, to learn from it, and to achieve revitalization. Ideally, as you become more adept at managing disruption and more skilled at resilience building, you are able to create and take advantage of new opportunities in good times and bad times, and this she calls the resilience dividend. It means more than effectively returning to normal functioning after disruption, although it is critical. It is about achieving significant transformation that yields benefits even when disruptions are not occurring. In the same vein, Nicholas Nassim Taleb introduced another term, anti-fragile. His proposition is that if fragile things break when exposed to stress, then something that is opposite of fragile would not just get hold together when put under pressure. Instead, it would actually get stronger. He terms this quality the quality of anti-fragility. And anti-fragility reminds me of early efforts to strengthen our defenses in Singapore against the threat of terrorism following 9/11 and the uncovering of the Jamiyah Islamiyah terrorist network in Singapore in December 2001. One urgent matter was to beef up the protection of Jurong Island, which is a vast petrochemical complex that had been designed for safety, but not for high-level security. The responsible authorities initially balked at the expense of upgrading. Eventually, they coughed up the money, albeit reluctantly. Not only did this dramatically strengthen the security of Jurong Island, but the security measures also became a selling point to investors in a world trying to cope with a rising threat of global terrorism. And I would argue that it is an example of an anti-fragile response. Taleb makes the case that human traditions have anti-fragility embedded in them. However, in today's modern world, many of these traditions seem to many either irrelevant or archaic. But these traditions developed for a reason and survived for so long because they serve some purpose. According to Taleb, traditions are often time-tested heuristics that make living in a volatile and uncertain world manageable. Now, several years ago, I had the privilege of visiting Port Blair, which is the capital of the Andaman and Nicobar Islands, which at that time had limited accessibility. And during that visit, we were briefed on the unique flora and fauna of Andamans. And within this unique ecosystem, I remember North Sentinel Island stood out for me. It is a tiny island occupied by a Stone Age tribe that is supposed to indulge in cannibalism. And so the Indians, for good reason, steer clear of the island. Not long after my visit, the 2004 Boxing Day tsunami washed through the Andaman Islands and swept over North Sentinel Island. An Indian friend told me that some days later, the Indians flew a helicopter over the island without landing, which I guess was a prudent precaution against a close encounter with a hungry tribe. And they discovered to their surprise that the tribe had survived the catastrophe that had killed 2,000 in the Andamans. They surmised that the tribe, through the millennia, had developed an ability to read the warning signs of an impending tsunami. Perhaps the waters turned a different color, or the birds and animals got disturbed, and then to flee to a high point at the center of the island. Now, if this surmise is correct, then tsunamis must have occurred in that area in the past. The knowledge of these warning signs seems to be part of an oral tradition passed from generation to generation, much like more sophisticated examples of oral traditions such as the Iliad and the Odyssey, the Three Kingdoms, the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, whose origins go back thousands of years. Such knowledge is obviously tacit because tsunamis occur very infrequently in places like North Sentinel Island. Let me turn to another example at this point, France. France is no stranger to terrorism inspired by a variety of causes: Corsican nationalism, French nationalism, the Palestinian cause, and Algeria. But I remember that before 9/11, the French security authorities were most concerned about what they termed the third generation problem. The problem was explained to me this way. The first generation of migrants from North Africa were grateful that they had been able to find a home in France and an opportunity to a life better than the hardscrabble one they had left behind. The second generation, that is their children, imbibed from their parents a sense of the benefits that migration had provided them. But it was their children's children, the third generation, who were the big challenge. They had no memory of their original homeland, but felt alienated in their country of birth, France. But the security authorities felt helpless to do anything about the problem. They did not have the resources, nor were they allocated the resources to deal with the problem, which at that time must have seemed like an abstraction. But of course, with the rise of radical Islam and the emergence of the Islamic State, the problem has come home to roost. In the last 2 years, France experienced the 7 January 2015 attack on the offices of Charlie Hebdo, the satirical weekly. 17 people were killed. Then on 13th November 2015, a rampage of shootings and suicide bombings in Paris killed 130 people. On Bastille Day this year, a 19-ton truck rammed into crowds in Nice, killing 86 people. The French have shown remarkable resilience, even defiance, in the face of these threats. Soon after the Charlie Hebdo shooting, Je suis Charlie became a powerful rallying cry. It symbolized support for the freedom of speech and the freedom of press. It was used as a hashtag on Twitter, and within 2 days it had become one of the most popular news hashtags in Twitter history. Yet, underneath the symbolic rhetoric, the fabric of society itself may be tearing. In the month after the Charlie Hebdo attack, there were at least 160 attacks on Muslim people and the Muslim community. This was more than the total number of attacks in 2014. To be sure, these tensions did not develop only after the attacks. In October 2005, two French youths of Malian and Tunisian descent were electrocuted as they fled the police in a Paris suburb. Nearly 3 weeks of riots followed, causing 20 million euros of damage and injuring 126 policemen and firemen. Longer-term issues are clearly at play here: social and economic exclusion, racial discrimination, and the capacity of the secular state to integrate cultural and ethnic diversity. And this has not been lost on the political actors in France. Nicolas Sarkozy, a former president, vowed both to ban the wearing of the veil in public and to take up the war against burkinis with new zeal during his campaign for the 2017 presidential elections. And speaking after the Nice attacks, Marine Le Pen, leader of the National Front, said, "The war against the scourge of Islamic fundamentalism has not begun. It is urgent now to declare it." In having to face down the threat of terrorism, the question is whether France's response is merely reactive or whether it exhibits both resilience and anti-fragility. As I noted earlier in the definition of by Judith Rodin, a resilient society not only returns to the state it was at before the disruption, it also adapts and grows. Similarly, an anti-fragile society reaches a new state, almost like a muscle tested by stress, growing stronger. For example, an anti-fragile response might include the promotion of social integration. Singapore has had its own brushes with terrorism. One was the 1974 hijack of the Laju ferry by members of the Japanese Red Army and the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine. Then on 7th December 2001, Singapore announced the detention of 13 members of the hitherto unknown Jamaah Islamiyah terrorist network dedicated to the establishment of the pan-Islamic caliphate in Southeast Asia. Since then, more than 60 people have been detained under the Internal Security Act for terror-related activities. Singapore has also beefed up security at soft targets. But besides these concrete measures, the government has also taken care to ensure that the Muslim community remains integrated into the broader society rather than becoming alienated from it. And the cornerstone of Singapore's counter-terrorism strategy is a community response plan. This enhances community vigilance, social cohesion, and community resilience. Singapore has built networks of community leaders and influencers by forming the Interracial and Religious Confidence Circle, or IRCC. And these leaders have helped strengthen the understanding and ties between different races and religions. And for the Muslim leaders, they not only speak out against those who distort Islam, but also use the media, mosque, and madrasa to assert mainstream Islamic values. Singapore is also one of only six countries with structured programs to rehabilitate and reintegrate terror detainees into society. The Religious Rehabilitation Group, or RRG, was set up in 2003 after the JI terror plots were thwarted. RRG counselors, all of them trained religious scholars and teachers, have helped terror detainees understand how they have been misguided by radical ideologies. The counseling sessions also extend to the family members of the detainees. Every released terror-related detainee in Singapore has undergone counseling as part of rehabilitation, and most have returned to their families, found jobs, and integrated back into Singapore society. The RRG also builds social resilience through outreach. It organizes conferences, dialogues, and briefings to educate its community, including schools and madrasas, about key Islamic concepts which have been misinterpreted and misrepresented by the terrorists and extremist groups such as JI, Al-Qaeda, and IS. Just as trust between the government and citizens in Singapore predated SARS, strengthening the social fabric has also been a key strategy since independence. Where migrants may naturally concentrate around the banlieues of Paris, Singapore takes an interventionist approach to promote social mixing. It uses quotas to avoid the buildup of racial enclaves in public housing estates. It has introduced a raft of policies to ensure that growth is inclusive. Investments in public education, grants for skills training, and tax credits for the working poor are all part of this. Strengthening the social fabric also means building anti-fragility through simulations. designed not only to hone citizens' and agencies' instincts of how to respond in crisis, but also to build confidence that we can overcome crisis. The psychological strengthening is part of what Singapore calls total defense. And the most recent initiative in this vein is SG Secure, which was also mentioned by Mr. Inderjit Singh. In addition to raising awareness, SG Secure also runs exercises. Recent examples include a simulated crisis in Chong Pang neighborhood in northern Singapore in September, and a big counterterrorism exercise dubbed Heartbeat at the Performing Arts Center in the Esplanade. Now, terrorism and disease outbreaks are all about diffusion of ideologies and pathogens. Both can be black elephants, risks that societies typically put off preparations for or avoid talking about altogether. The specific measures to secure installations or quarantine patients are necessary to helping societies bounce back from such disruptions. But the softer aspects, the diffusion of trusted information and weaving a tough and supple social fabric, are equally important, both in overcoming disruptions and ensuring that society survives. The underlying layer of trust and cohesion is what societies need to build in times of tranquility, even as they learn to hunt down black swans and to tame the black elephants that will surely visit societies and countries from time to time. We may not be able to preemptively hunt down all the animals in the menagerie of risk, but we can at least learn to live with them. That will be a product of good governance and the result and result in better and more resilient societies for all. Thank you.
Now we have time for questions and for discussions with Peter. Anybody has a question? Yes, there's a gentleman over there.
Good morning, Mr. Ho.
Hi.
Please name your name.
Edmund from NTU. What would you consider to be one of the biggest black swans on the international level and on the regional level? Would North Korea be considered... No, black elephant, sorry. What would you consider to be the most dangerous black elephant on the international level and the regional level? And would North Korea be considered a black elephant? Thank you.
What would be considered a black elephant would probably vary from country to country, and each has its own areas of concern. I would say for Singapore, we are confronting, I think, a whole range of potential disruptions, and it is not just the big political seismic shifts that are exemplified by Brexit and by the election of President Trump. It is also the accompanying challenges of rising nationalism, populism, protectionism, which are going to change the world that we have been used to living in for several decades. In fact, I think never have you seen so many storm clouds gathering at the same time to create a perfect storm. But there are, of course, other big challenges. I won't call them black elephants at this point because I think we are dealing with them. And these include the challenges imposed by technology. And remember, technology is not just about the challenges, the potential disruptions to jobs, but there are also huge opportunities in technology. I was just reading something written by Tom, I was reading a piece. This is, I think, World Economic Forum. 2/3 of the people in primary school today will have jobs which don't even exist now. It shows how far-reaching technology is going to have in terms of its impact on jobs. But are we ready for that? This is a question which all governments have to ask themselves. But there are huge opportunities. In fact, the best assessment is that with the changes of technology, there will be a net increase in the availability of new types of jobs. But are we ready to adapt to that? So jobs, technology is one thing. Another thing, of course, is going to be what's happening to our population. Our population is aging very fast. Are we ready to deal with the challenges of a rapidly aging population? Most developed countries around the world are facing this problem. We are aging very fast. How do we look after an aging population that is living longer? Is our system structured to look after aging people? Is our system structured to give them a meaningful career beyond their normal retirement age? These are big questions. So these are some of the things. You know, you just start thinking about them. There are so many issues we have to worry about. And the problem, I think, is the biggest black elephant of all is, do we have the bandwidth to cope with all these problems that are happening all at the same time?
Peter, thanks very much. I think it was an absolutely outstanding overview, and I hadn't come across black elephants before, so I was delighted to get both the metaphor and the way in which you dealt with it. I think you've said almost everything that needs to be said around the topic, but there's a tension in it between these two concepts of resilience in the expanded version that's in Judith's thing and Taleb's anti-fragility. And the tension between the two of them is that Judith's is deterministic, it's planned, it's the conscious creation of additional redundancy to deal with uncertainty, because that is what enables the not only recovery but the continued societal growth in the aftermath. And you know, you, with great respect, probably enjoy more. You should enjoy more praise for having created that redundancy within the Singaporean system. An enormous amount of what you've described is due precisely to RAS and the whole futures orientation in respect of it. But that's not quite what anti-fragility is. Anti-fragility is a description of a condition that already exists. It's not a planned outcome, it's a circumstance. And that's a little bit like evolutionary adaptation. Evolution is by definition non-deterministic. It occurs, adaptation occurs as a result of fitness. It occurs as a result of challenge. Now, how do we square that circle in societal terms? We can plan for redundancy. We can create capacity to be able to address fragility and to address disruption. But that probably isn't sufficient in all circumstances. How do societies internalize, in the absence of trust, the ability to be able to adapt proactively and responsively from crisis?
I accept your point. In fact, regarding Judith's approach to resilience, which is you can build in more into resilience than just returning back to normal, I think it's something all governments, all societies should strive for, and that you can do. Anti-fragility is a bit like that, but as you say, it's an evolution. You have got to that point, perhaps because you have survived millennia of disasters and catastrophes, and somehow you have muddled through. And I think you can actually have these things coexist. You see, the question really is, if you are a society that can both plan and is already anti-fragile as a result of a lot of bitter experience, then that's an ideal situation. But on the other hand, if you don't have that capacity to plan, either because of poor governance or poor systems, and then you are just stuck with this hope that you are anti-fragile, you may be, a lot of these dysfunctional countries are like that. You know, they are anti-fragile in the sense that they can somehow continue to function. In fact, Taleb actually told me that one of his prime examples of an anti-fragile society country is his home country, Lebanon. Now, you have to ask yourself, what's missing in that equation? Yes, it's survived, it's bounced back, it's got all the qualities of anti-fragility. But on the other hand, what is missing is the other part, which is the system itself resilient as a result of planning, and can it make itself even better than what it is today? So I think that is the missing part of the equation. Let's look at China. China has had its ups and downs in history. You know, in the Three Kingdoms, it talks about empires waxing and waning. So they've had the experience of ups and downs. So they know the consequences of what happens when things are down. So that's, I think, given it an ability, a certain, not just a resilient capacity, but also an anti-fragile capacity. I think they're going through an anti-fragile period in their history. They are learning and they are doing important things. But I think, to my mind, certain things you are master of, certain things you are not master of. You can master resilience as defined by Judith Rodin. It's much more difficult to talk about anti-fragility because that evolves over a long time and it's embedded in your cultural DNA, your societal response. It's, in some ways, it's civilizational if you think about it in regard to societies. So I think that is the issue.
I'm Sheila Ranis from the United States. I'm really curious as to how, with black elephants, many of the ways to ameliorate or respond require collaboration, not only within your olive government and even olive society within Singapore, but also with all of your neighbors and partners and friends around the world. How is Singapore actively trying to create those kinds of partnerships?
I mean, the whole diplomatic effort, if you could say, of Singapore is centered around creating those collaborative relationships. So one of them is Singapore's priority on building a strong ASEAN, Association of Southeast Asian Nations. That's a very central part of our effort to build a more resilient neighborhood. But of course, without going into details, it has its challenges. So I would say yes, you do try to build not just resilience within the nation, you try to build resilience within the larger neighborhood, and in fact internationally. But once you go beyond your immediate country, your nation, then you're confronted with the reality of having to deal with different countries who have different priorities, who don't necessarily see the world in the same way as you do, and therefore it becomes much more challenging. That's why, you know, all these international multilateral systems have so much challenges, because they really have to deal with a diversity of views and diversity of attitudes. It's no longer easy to say that, oh, you know, this is the problem and therefore let's solve it together. If only that was that simple. That's why it's very important to understand the concept of wicked problems, because a wicked problem like climate change, you might say, oh, all of us share the same point of view. No, not all of us share the same point of view. If you are in a developing country, you think the rich country should bear the burden. If you are in industry, you might have a different point of view. So it's not so easy. So this is why it's much more difficult to take that conversation of regional resilience beyond your immediate national borders.
Roland Fletcher from the University of Sydney. I was very pleased that you just commented on climate change, because many of your previous examples and the questions which have been raised related to very particularly social and socio-political phenomena. Can you elaborate a little bit about how you see these notions of resilience and anti-fragility relating to an issue on the scale of climate change, which we now have to confront?
Well, climate change, in my humble opinion, falls within the category of the black elephant. That is, countries actually have taken a very long time to confront that elephant in the room, which is climate change, and it is because of, you know, phenomenon like Jared Diamond's creeping normality. You know, it's a frog in boiling water problem. You know, you don't deal with it until it's become, in a sense, too late, or rather late. So this is what we are confronting today. We are confronting a problem that could have been nipped in the bud a few decades ago, when some scientists were waving the red flag, but nobody either took notice of that, or if they did, it was too big a problem for them to even contemplate dealing with then. So this is a real problem. Now we've reached a point that, okay, we've got the Paris Accords. There's even a question mark now over how well the Paris Accords will be implemented, because in some ways the Paris agreements are all voluntary. And then there's a question of whether the United States is going to stick to its part of the bargain, and the US is a big player in this. But assuming it does, there's also a question whether, in fact, the Paris agreements are too little, too late. So the 2-degree target, where does it lead us? Are we going to hit the 2-degree target even if everyone lives up to their commitments? Some say we may actually overshoot the 2-degree target even if everybody sticks to their commitments. So what happens? I think we are confronting both the problem of having to wean ourselves from a kind of economy that's dependent on carbon economy, and also at the same time adapting to the problem of higher temperatures. And adapting to a problem of high temperatures, I think, is a very serious problem. If you are living in a Pacific island state, it's going to be a real problem. Your island state may no longer exist 50 years from now, because you're all going to be covered by rising sea levels. Even in Singapore, we've had to raise the level of certain parts of the island that are considered to be prone to, vulnerable to rising sea levels. In the end, we may end up like the Netherlands, building dikes and then living in a polder kind of environment. The difference is, in Singapore, we've got the resources to do that if we decide to do it. Many countries don't have that resource. Then what's going to happen? We'll have all these climate refugees, climate migration. That's going to be a big challenge. Bangladesh, 40% of that country is at risk to rising sea levels. 40%, imagine. And what is it? Population. So it's a huge problem. So I think it is not just living up to the commitments made in Paris, but also adaptation. What are we going to do to adapt?
Well, thank you very much, Jacques Werner. Indeed, Ambassador of the Netherlands, that country that you refer to, that partly lives below sea level. By the way, Singapore is embarking on a very interesting project itself by introducing the polder in Singapore at Pulau Tekong. So that will be a game changer for Singapore as well. Maybe I could make just 3 brief remarks. The one on polders and resilience. Indeed, we are reinforcing our dikes for obvious reasons. But at the same time, we will live with the fact or with the assumption that we will be flooded once every 10,000 years, which means that we cannot only live by reinforcing our dikes, but at the same time, the people should be resilient as well. Interesting detail here is perhaps that our Minister for Infrastructure a few years ago trying to warn and prepare the Dutch population against a possible flooding. Not that there was an immediate danger, but just the Dutch people will be responsible for their own evacuation. Obviously, the government will help, but people should have their rucksack with emergency instruments and gadgets ready just in case we get flooded. So resilience is a matter of reinforcing the dikes, but also of a population being ready in case the time comes. The second remark is on another black swan, which is actually avian flu. We have avian flu in the Netherlands, again, since 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Now, this used to be a huge problem and a big black swan, but it seems that these black swans, we are now getting ready, more ready for them as well. We are overshooting in our response, so it means we are clearing the area around the infected farm. In fact, we're killing all the chickens within one mile radius in order to make sure that it doesn't spread, and obviously we're stopping the transportation of chickens because it might spread through that way. So we are in the terms of Gochaktong, we are overshooting, but indeed I suppose that is the best reaction under the circumstances. And I feel there's less of an emergency feeling because we are now getting used, I mean how bad it is in itself, we're getting used to these sort of emergency arrangements. My third and last point is on both of you interjecting, and you, Peter, mentioned Lehman Brothers in passing. And it made me think of the financial and economic crisis and how it started in the U.S. And obviously, it was a big disruption as we all went into crisis. But then again, for the banking industry, I wonder whether it was such a big disruption. It seemed more like a hiccup. After the crisis, actually, the question is, did the banking industry, was it disrupted because of the crisis, or did it moved on in the way it had been doing before the crisis? I believe part of the analysis was that there were, in fact, perverse stimuli in the banking system. And I believe today, at least at what I read every now and then, I believe today they're still there. To the extent that there is disruption in the banking industry, it's mostly because of startups, crowdfunding, and internet way of providing for financial services, rather than that the banking industry has been disrupted itself as a result of the crisis. So I'm wondering, actually, whether the absence of a disruptive development could be just as serious or risky as a disruptive development in itself.
Thank you. Those are, I think, excellent observations. I just want to respond, if you will, if you allow me, to the points which you raise. First, I think, the ability of the Dutch people to talk about what they need to do in the event that there's a flood is not just a sign of a resilient and a mature society. It reflects my belief that when we're dealing with the big risks, there must be some... You cannot prepare for these kind of big risks unless there is some kind of dialogue, and it has to be a national dialogue. Agreeing on what is the big risk facing a country or facing a society is very much a social construct. If you're not prepared to talk about it, then you're not going to be prepared for it. So you have to deal with the elephant in the room, otherwise it becomes a black elephant, and when you're surprised or when you become shocked by it, it's already too late. So you really do have to have an ability to talk about what the big risks are. My observation about avian flu, I want to tie it to climate change, because as temperatures rise, we are seeing how disease which are confined to the tropical zones, that means the equatorial zones, beginning to spread further northwards because of rising temperatures. So I'm reminded that dengue fever, which you know is endemic in Singapore, I think was it last year, started to appear in Tokyo, and they had to close some of their national parks because they wanted to break the dengue cycle. But dengue is actually only associated with tropical climates. Now imagine it's getting hot enough, long enough in places like Tokyo. So I think if you are in temperate countries like Europe or the northern parts of the North America, better start worrying about these kind of second and third order effects. On the banking industry, yes and no. I mean, it's very clear that the global economic and financial crisis was a big disruption. But of course, it looks as if maybe governments were treating the banks as the black elephant, you know, too big to fail. You know, so they're not going to let any of these things fail. As they say, hardly any big name in banking who was involved in some nefarious aspect of the crisis has been thrown into jail. So there's no, in a sense, disruption. So disruption may have to come through another crisis, or somebody decides enough is enough and we are going to go after these people. So I think it is an issue. And the question is, to get that going for a global banking system, you need global leadership. And where's that global leadership going to come from?
I'm Peter Vail from the Johannesburg Institute for Advanced Study. Could you tell us what you think university people should be teaching their students and what skills we should be imparting to them in the context of what you've been talking about?
Well, I'm a big proponent of interdisciplinary learning. And so I think it is to deal with a lot of these big issues which we are facing today. It's no longer good enough to be good in your own discipline. It's very important to be able to understand the larger world we live in, and this means you must have some ability to look at things in a very cross-disciplinary, interdisciplinary way. That's a reflection of the complex world we live in. So it's no point just trying to understand a problem from the perspective of climatologist or perspective of an engineer or scientist. You must also understand the societal drivers which cause some of the issues to become more acute. So I would say multidisciplinary learning is a very important part of that.
Thanks very much, Peter, for your presentation. Han Fuk Kwang, recently with NTU, Rajaratnam School. I have a question concerning the relationship between the government and the people, and specifically with issues of resilience and anti-fragility, and specifically concerning Singapore. You know, the government here is acknowledged for being highly efficient and effective. It's very dominant. It's involved in almost all aspects of life here, and you've mentioned some of the programs that it is involved in. But at the same time, some people worry that as a result, the people have become overly dependent on the government. They have not developed, you know, the instincts and the capacity to solve problems on their own. And especially in these more challenging times, in fact, I see the government being more and more involved in many of the issues that you have mentioned, you know, concerning how to protect Singapore society from some of these disruptions. So my question is, how do you see this? How do you see Singapore transiting from a situation in which it is highly dependent on the government to one where the people take more responsibilities for solving some of these problems? Does the government need to step back, or modify some of those programs so that they allow people to take responsibility and allow civic society, for example, to play a more active part in solving some of these problems?
Yeah, I think that goes to the heart of some of the issues which we have been talking about. Because ideally, a resilient system, and I'm talking about a country, a resilient system should not just have a government that is very resilient in its thinking, always trying to anticipate where the problems are, and when the problem arises, where there's a crisis, it's got the resources to deal with it. But a resilient system must also be able to depend on the other parts of society, that means the people sector and the private sector, to also have resilient responses rather than just depending on government. And I don't think there's anything fundamentally wrong with the government getting involved in trying to develop programs like we talked about Skills Future, or SG Secure, and doing all the things it did during some of these black swan events like SARS. But on the other hand, you also have to be able to find a way to involve, let society in a way chart its own course forward as far as possible. And I'm not exactly sure whether because we have been so successful in as a government in handling all these problems, that people have become, as you point out, in a way too dependent on that. And that is not necessary in the long run a recipe for long-term resilience, where you're only dependent. In other words, it's potentially a single point of failure, because if something goes wrong with the government and people are dependent on government, then you've got a problem. If some misjudgment on the part of government, or the government is just weak, and then people are just looking to the government for answers, the government cannot provide the answers. Right now, we've been lucky. For 50 years, the government has provided a lot of the answers. So how do you find that balance between a strong and effective government, which deals with some of the big problems, and a society itself that has the built-in resilience, the anti-fragility, which we've been talking about? And that, I'm not exactly sure how to do that. Because it means that for certain things, the government has to take a foot off the pedal and let others do it. But the propensity of government is, once they start doing well, expectations raise, and if they're running for the next elections, they have to do even better then. And so they're reluctant to take the foot off the pedal. So, but I think actually, as I said, I don't have the answers, but it's fundamentally a big issue. And unfortunately, this is not a problem which the political parties themselves can solve. It's society itself has to decide, how it wants to take charge of itself. I remember, I'm not just talking about the people sector. I'm also talking about the private sector. I know the private sector, we try to say, let the private sector regulate itself. The private sector hates self-regulation. They don't like to self-regulate, even though the government has tried to allow them to regulate themselves in certain things. And why do they hate self-regulation? Because if things go wrong, they don't have the government to blame anymore. So I think this is a part of dilemma, but I would say it's one of the most important issues for Singapore to face going forward in the future. We must talk about this problem, and we must deal with this problem.
There's rising inequality across the world in developed economies, emerging economies, developing economies. Is this another black elephant that is insidious and is going to increase and create, and we may be seeing the start of these instabilities in all the political turmoil? How would you classify
that? I think... I think inequality is definitely a big issue, whether it's a black elephant or something which governments recognize. I think it is behind many of the problems we see. I would arguably things like Brexit, even the Donald Trump phenomenon are part of a response or reaction to rising global inequality. In fact, I just give you a sense of what this inequality means. Imagine a map of the world. The poorest 50% of the world would only own a country the size of Mongolia. Then the next 40% would own the GDP of Russia and Kazakhstan. And then the top 10% own everything else. So just picture it, how unequal the world is. And of course, that inequality is even more extreme in countries like the United States, where they say 1% own something like 75% of the wealth. And it's a problem everywhere. Singapore is not exempt from this challenge. And the issue is, if you cannot reduce the inequality, you're going to increase social tensions. And then when the tensions increase, you're going to get perverse outcomes like Brexit and I don't know what happened in the United States, where people lose their trust in the establishment because they feel the establishment is not able to deliver the goods. They don't trust their politicians anymore, so they're prepared to consider snake oil options. And more than that, they lose their trust in things like globalization and in free trade because they see no benefits accruing to them. So even in the future world of great innovation, where an innovation is accelerating, does that spread the goodies around, or does it make a few people who are very innovative, very rich, and everybody else where they are? We don't know, but this is, an issue that is of great importance. And whether it's a black elephant or not, it's up to the country or nation or government to decide whether it's going to be a black elephant or something else. Hopefully it shouldn't be a black elephant. Hopefully they confront and deal with the problem. But when you don't deal with a problem, I think you get very perverse outcomes. And I think we're seeing this happen everywhere, unfortunately.
Well, Mr. Ho, thank you very much for a comprehensive analysis of things. But would you care to enlighten us to, during your terms of office as head of civil service and in the present scenario, that the government do a lot of mindstorming in order to fit itself in a generation of mind sharing and mind thinking, very much in the sense that design thinking and system design. So do you have, by your own personal knowledge, that the government have got an insider kind of committee that, that quarterly, bring up issues of these, the unthinkable, the unknown, and unspoken to be, that you think that, worthwhile for the publics to know the progress in the towards the thinking of the nation? Because when you say, I was surprised when we talk about smart nation and it without an EA, without enterprise architecture. So the question is that dislocation, when you go for aiming at smart nation without a smart society. So the question is that, do you think that a lot of re-engineerings, redefinition, recollection need to be done? Because when you mentioned about the Lebanese writer, well, in Lebanon itself, he is not able to convince anybody towards a positive reaction. So the crisis in Lebanon is forever be hanging out of balance. So do we do a lot of load balancing that you think that Singapore is very, very well prepared? Because it looks to me that, when we talk about smart nation, you find that even at Boston, you couldn't find a kind of simple thing. You go to the polyclinic, thinks everything is not in order. So how are we going to say that a kind of label, but not delivering that label? Thanks a lot.
Well, you bundled a lot of points in your remarks, and perhaps I think some of them need to be addressed this way. First, I think, you know, in every system, and a system like Singapore, I think, and I travel quite a bit, I would say Singapore system is actually by and large a superior system. And there may be problems here and there. You may have MRT breakdowns. You may have a blackout of your Singtel broadband and things like that. But, you know, these are far and few between. And it is not a symptom of something that has gone wrong. You know, I think we have to give credit where credit is due. The system runs actually very well. But the issue for Smart Nation to me is not whether there's an enterprise architecture. That's not the issue. That's the least of the issues. The big issue for Smart Nation is what do you imagine Singapore of the future to be? And then the technology is actually all there. So what do we want the future to be? And we need people with ideas who are dreaming big dreams, who would imagine Singapore 10, 20 years down the road, and imagine Singapore as a smart nation 10, 20 years down the road. We then put the resources to try some of these ideas out. So to me, that is more important for Singapore, the smart nation, than any enterprise architecture. So I think that is one point. On your point about, you know, what do we see? I mean, nobody has. If there's a black swan, it's going to surprise us anyway. You know, no, very little we can do in terms of spotting black swans unless you are a prophet or you're just plain lucky. Sometimes you spot things because you're lucky. But the point about the world we live in is we can do better in terms of looking for trends. And you cannot look for these trends only by talking among ourselves. It's very important to engage a lot of people who have different points of view. You may not always agree with them, but sometimes they have ideas and sometimes they can point you in new directions to start exploring, start looking. That's why I think one of the reasons why we set up the Center for Strategic Futures, which Jan kindly referred to, is we need to have conversations, and we have conversations not just within government, we have conversations outside government and with people internationally, because we need to have fresh insights, fresh points of view, alternative points of view.
Morning, Mr. Ho. I just want to share more insights, if you have, on IoT, the landscape. What are your thoughts? You hinted briefly in your previous response. My original question was, what do you think is the missing link to make this industry harness its full potential? Earlier you mentioned it's about imagination. If we can think of the future, is that the only missing link? And my second question is, you also mentioned about global trends. I was wondering, following our late founding father, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, and then Dr. Henry Kissinger, is there anyone else on the global field you think would be able to give us some insights on a good reading of global trends? Thank you.
I think on your last question, you know, don't think that any single person has a monopoly of insights. In fact, sometimes it's looking at people who keep a very low profile, who can often offer more interesting insights. Because those who are keeping a high profile, you've already read what they have said, you're not going to get anything interesting from them. Whereas people who keep low profiles, sometimes you get really very interesting things. So keep your net wide. I didn't quite catch your point about Internet of Things. What about it?
As a booming like industry, and you mentioned it's the first wave coming, but I'm wondering, like, what is the missing link in this industry to really make it work, to harness the full potential? Is it just in the cloud system, getting people to, as in getting the different devices to talk to each other, or
beyond
that?
It's probably all of the above. You have increasing connectivity, the the intelligence you can build into, you know, your day-to-day devices are getting cheaper and cheaper because of Moore's Law. So your everything is going to be connected to everything else. So the question is, how do you use that connectivity? And it's also a problem because these things are not secure at the moment. In fact, anything that you say is part of Internet of Things actually has no security, and we're beginning to see the dangers of the Internet of Things having no security. So we can spend all our time and effort securing our emails and our computers, but your Internet of Things, which is also connected to these computers, has no security. So there's one big yawning hole. So I think, you know, these things will just happen, but if you were paying attention to the Internet of Things, you'd also be worried about security, I think.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Let's thank Peter Ho.